So let's start then with a couple of questions that Gary Dean has posted. Gary, unfortunately, is unable to be part of these interactive sessions, but he does listen in later, I believe. So, first question, from my reading over the years, I'm beginning to understand Siddhartha Gautama to be a philosopher who established a school of ethics and practice about 2,500 years ago. I speculate that, like other philosophical schools of that period, Gautama's school sought to build a civilizational system of ethics that was compatible with emerging large urban polities that had begun to develop. Exactly. I couldn't have said it more succinctly than you did, Gary. That's exactly how I feel. And that's very much the direction that my work, my writing, and my talks and retreats are all trying to recover the philosopher that has often been forgotten or buried, concealed by the quasi-godlike figure of the Buddha as he has evolved over this time into essentially the founder and the leader and the exemplifier of a particular religion, the religion we call Buddhism. And for those of you who may not have such a clear sense of the history here, it's well worth bearing in mind that Gautama was a contemporary of Socrates. They lived effectively at the same time in the 4th century BC. And many of the philosophical schools that grew up in Greece after Socrates, I'm thinking particularly of the Stoics, the Epicureans, the Skeptics, and others, presented a way of life, a way of practice, a system of ethics that in many ways parallels the work that Gautama sought to establish in India. Remember that there was a fair amount of contact between India and the Greek world at that time, largely because of the Persian Empire that connected the two. Parts of Pakistan and parts of modern day Greece were actually part of the same empire, the Achaemenid Empire of the Persians, and there was an enormous amount of intercultural exchange going on in this period. So I don't want to suggest that the Buddha borrowed all his stuff from Greece, and I certainly wouldn't want to suggest the opposite, that the Greeks borrowed all their stuff from the Buddhists. That's not really possible to prove one way or the other. But I think what is clear is that economically and socially, these two societies were developing into urban communities with monarchs ruling, and that these social and economic conditions, I think, brought human beings to ask very similar kinds of questions, and that their philosophers and their thinkers, not surprisingly, came up with ways to address these questions that bear a number of similarities with each other. So I sense that if we see parallels between the Buddha, between Socrates, between the Hellenists, and so on, we're actually uncovering a similar thought world that existed across the ancient cultures of India, of Persia, of Greece. And I think that's probably the best reason for their being so similar in many ways. But what's happened to Buddhism, as of course we know, is that it became very much a religious philosophy rather than just a philosophy. It adopted many of the beliefs of ancient India. It established hierarchies of priests. It established temples. It established forms of ritual behavior and whatnot. And in some ways, I think that the core philosophy somehow got buried and got obscured. So what I would aspire to in our day and age would be not only to recover the philosophical way of life that the Buddha introduced, but also to recognize that it has numerous resonances with the sources of our own Western culture. And I feel that this is you know, very important thing to do, to get out of the idea that Buddhism is somehow alien or Indian thought belongs somewhere else, and to recognize that what we're really tapping into are the fundamental questions as to what it means to be human. This is Gary's second question. It seems to me that Gautama did not establish Buddhism, nor did he seek or desire to establish a religion. Quite the contrary, it appears if we are to believe the early sources. So my question is this: is it not problematic to refer to Gautama's school of ethics and practice as secular Buddhism? Isn't there a more appropriate pronoun that can be used that does not evoke religiosity or mysticism or association with the Buddhist religion? This is again a very good point. And in fact, although I do use the word secular Buddhism, I'm preferring more and more to not use that language, but to speak instead of a secular Dharma. And the courses that I run at Bodhi College, for example, are not entitled secular Buddhism. They are a two-year course in secular Dharma. And the reason I'm trying to let go of the notion of Buddhism is precisely because it immediately associates it with the Buddhist religion, the religiosity, and sometimes the mysticism that is associated with that term. And I don't think that's really terribly helpful. The problem with Dharma, though, is that so many people simply don't know what it means. Whether you like it or not, Buddhism is intelligible, whereas for some people, the word Dharma wouldn't make much sense at all. So in some ways, one's somehow beholden to the historical reality of our times and so on, and to keep using that term. But ultimately, I'd like to let go of this language altogether and to articulate the Buddha's Dharma as very much an ethical, philosophical, and contemplative practice. Practice being key, but I think it's more than just ethics, it's also contemplation, in other words, meditation, spiritual exercises, and so forth, which are very, very important in Buddhism, the Dharma. And likewise, philosophy. I think if you don't have a coherent and view of the world and where you as a human being somehow are located within that world, it's difficult, I think, to have a clear sense of purpose or direction to what a practice or an ethics might seek as their goal.